Good evening, everyone. On behalf of Abbott, we welcome you to today's session of the cardiac essentials of cardiac pacing by Dr. Kumar Narayanan. So, am I audible to all?
Yes, you are audible.
So thank you all for joining. I'll just take a half a minute to kind of introduce Dr. Kumar Narayanan. So he's we have with us Dr. Kumar Narayanan, who is one of the most senior electrophysiologists currently employed at Medicover Hospitals Hyderabad, and he has done his fellowship from Cedar Sinai Medical Center USA, and he has been a regular teacher when it comes to kind of teaching us on the basics of pacing. For the last 3 years we have been conducting this course. So given the current scenario, we are trying to explore the opportunity to kind of do the same over this WebEx for a four-part session starting today. There will be three more sessions that will continue on 13th, 20th and 27th of June. I feel the agenda has already been shared. So without further ado, I would request Dr. Kumar Narayanan to start this today's session. Thank you, sir, again, and I'll just mute myself.
Thank you, Shriram, for a kind introduction. So I welcome you all the participants to this first lecture. Actually, this is meant to be a mini course. So I would encourage all participants to try and attend all the sessions. So we have planned four sessions. And generally, we were doing this as a on-site program spread out over 1.5 days, where we were basically covering the different concepts of cardiac pacing. Now, this is a course which is basically meant to cover the essential concepts. We are not going to go into some exceptional situations or very advanced nuances. Of course, we can have some discussion if some of you have specific doubts. But this is essentially meant to clarify the basic concepts and to kind of make you comfortable when you are dealing with some of the common terms which you encounter whenever a pacemaker patient comes up, or whenever you know you're doing an interrogation for a pacemaker. So the aim is that the common terms which you encounter should not fluster you, or you should not be confused as to, you know, what am I supposed to do in this situation. So given that we have planned only four sessions, we chose the four most important, what I felt, the topics, so that you can kind of have a grasp of most of the common things which you encounter. So today we'll be covering the concepts of pacing, threshold, impedance, and sensing, which are the basic, you know, essentials, you can say, the basic concepts. Then next we will go on to timing cycles, which are quite important and are often confusing. Then we will, in the third session, look at some of the common algorithms which are very much being used, and you should be aware of how these algorithms work, and you know what the different messages which a pacemaker interrogation is displaying, what does it mean. And sometimes a lack of knowledge of these algorithms can make you whereas the issue would be actually the particular way an algorithm works. And then in the fourth session we are going to try and show you online, give you some kind of demos of a programming setup and how to approach a basic kind of programming in the clinic. So we'll get started with today's topic, which is basically going to be certain basic pacemaker concepts. All right. So I'm going to be sharing my screen. You can see the presentation. You're able to see the presentation?
Yes, sir. We can see your presentation, sir.
Okay, good. So let's get started on this. So today we are going to talk about four things. Pacing and threshold are interlinked. Then we are going to talk about lead impedance. And then we are going to talk about the basic concepts in sensing. All of you know the essential of a pacemaker. So you have a pulse generator, which encompasses both the battery as well as the electronic circuits within. And then attached to it, and then getting into the various cardiac chambers, the different leads, depending on how many chambers you are trying to pace, you have that many number of leads. So the leads are the functional element which are linking the myocardium to the pulse generator, and the pacemaker depends on the leads to both get information as well as to convey information to the myocardium. So the two essential functions which any pacemaker has to do are pacing and sensing. Take this one by one. What exactly is pacing? It's nothing but artificial cardiac electrical stimulation. So through a pacemaker, we are applying an external electrical signal or an external to generate a self-propagating cardiac depolarization, and is able to do because of the effects on the transmembrane potential. So capture myocardium, there are three prerequisites met. One, you should have a stimulus of sufficient amplitude, generally talked of in voltage, but we'll talk about the different ways we can think about amplitude. This amplitude has to be applied for a sufficient duration of time. So we will find that even if you apply a huge amplitude, but for an extremely short duration of time, that will not be sufficient for myocardial capture. At the same time, if you give it for a pretty long duration, but you don't have a minimum threshold which is present, then again, you won't be able to capture the myocardium. And last, the third point is more physiological, something which is not in the pacemaker's control, that the heart should be in an excitable period. It should not be in its own refractory period. So these three prerequisites are necessary, out of which the first two are what is under our control or under the pacemaker's control. So in delivering the stimulus to achieve pacing, you have certain variables which are basically nothing but the concepts of electricity which we have all learnt in physics. So you have voltage, you have current, you have resistance. So the amount of current which you deliver depends on the voltage and depends on the resistance. And we'll talk about the resistance of the circuit in a little more detail as we go along. And finally, depending on how much voltage and current you are spending, that is the energy drain on the pacemaker, which you measure in joules. And the fundamental Ohm's law, which you remember from our school days, I is equal to V by R, is going to apply to this electrical circuit as well. Now, we talked about voltage, and that's generally the term which you will find is being used in most of the pacemaker interrogations, or when you're looking at an implant, they will talk about voltage as far as the stimulation amplitude is concerned. But if you actually look at the physics of it, what is finally responsible directly for stimulating the myocardium is the magnitude of current which is flowing per unit mass of myocardium. And this is known as the current density. So if you have an adequate amount of current for a given mass of myocardial tissue, then you will be able to achieve myocardial capture. And this current is in turn related mainly to the voltage and the resistance, and also to some of the other factors. This is important to understand when we talk a little bit about the design of the electrode tips. So let's now go a little further on these terms. What is the stimulation threshold? We all talk about the threshold when we are talking about a pacemaker. So this is the minimum amplitude which is required at a given pulse, which is required to consistently achieve myocardial capture or myocardial depolarization. So the minimum stimulus which you need to give to achieve capture, and you can express this in volts or amperes, that is current. And traditionally, most of the time, you'll find that it is being expressed in volts. Understand also the difference between pacing and defibrillation. Now, we are not going to go into ICDs in this particular session, but in pacing, to give enough stimulus to achieve local depolarization of one small segment of the heart. Then the rest will be achieved by the heart's own system to self-propagation of the depolarization. So you don't need to capture a large extent of the myocardium. On the other hand, for defibrillation, you have to directly depolarize a bit of myocardium because you're defibrillating in order to interrupt an arrhythmia, reentrant circuit which is going on, and that you cannot do unless you capture most of the bulk of the myocardium instantaneously. So defibrillation requires much more energy and much more stimulus intensity, whereas pacing typically requires only a small amplitude and a small intensity. So you'll understand immediately that obviously pacemakers can be expected to have a better battery life as compared to defibrillators, which need to have a lot of energy to defibrillate the heart. The second important thing is, we talked about the fact that the stimulation threshold is the minimum stimulus at a given pulse width. So the duration, as I said, is always important, and these two always go hand in hand. So when you talk about threshold, never forget about the duration or the pulse width. Now, why is this important? Because as I said, even if you apply a very large amplitude, but you're applying it for an extremely short duration, you're not going to be able to capture the myocardium. So what is the relationship between the strength of the stimulus and the duration? It turns out that the amplitude required for stimulation has an exponential relation to the pulse duration. So there is a curve that I'll show you. And the characteristic of this curve is important to bear in mind. So this is the strength duration curve or the strength duration relationship, which is fundamental to understanding how the pacemaker threshold and how the energy drain on a pacemaker works. So here, if you see on the y-axis, you have the stimulation threshold, and on the x-axis, you have the duration for which you are applying that stimulus, or in other words, the pulse width. Now, this is expressed classically in milliseconds, okay? So here you can see from left to right, the pulse width is progressively increasing from zero, and here we are going up to 1.5, and then you can keep on going. And here the threshold volts is again increasing, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so forth. Now you can see that if you apply the stimulus for a very short duration of time, you require a great voltage to stimulate the myocardium. If you apply the pulse width, if you apply the stimulus for a longer pulse width, then you require a lesser amplitude to stimulate the myocardium. And this relationship curve, this is an exponential relationship. Now, what does an exponential relationship mean? It means that there is a relatively flat portion towards the right, and then as you come towards the left, it becomes a steeply ascending curve. In other words, if your pulse width is going to keep decreasing beyond a certain point, the amount of voltage required to stimulate the myocardium is going to sharply or exponentially increase. On the other hand, if you keep on increasing your pulse width, can you keep on reducing your threshold or your stimulus amplitude? No, you can't do that. Beyond a certain pulse width, you can see that the amplitude begins to flatten out and pretty much becomes a horizontal line. So what does this mean? It means that beyond the pulse width, here in this figure, it is shown to be, for example, 1 milliseconds, but this differs. It can be 1.3, 1.5, 2, whatever. But beyond a specific pulse width, no matter how much you increase the pulse width after that, the amount of voltage required is not going to come down anymore. So irrespective of the pulse width, the minimum voltage which you require to stimulate the myocardium is known as the Rho base voltage. So the Rho base voltage is the minimum you require. Then there is another point on the strength duration curve, which is important to remember, and that's known as the Kronecky point. The Kronecky point is nothing but take the Rho base voltage, double it, Okay, so for example, here if the Rho base is roughly 1, you're going to about 2 here. And look at what is the pulse width at that point. Let's say it's about 0.2 milliseconds. And that pulse width is the Kronaxy pulse width. So these two parameters you need to define that again. The Rho base is the lowest stimulus current that can capture the heart, irrespective of the pulse width. In this situation, further increases in stimulus duration no longer reduce the magnitude of the current required to stimulate the heart. And the Kronaxy is nothing but the pulse width at twice the Rho base amplitude. Now, how can you know the Rho base in a given patient? For clinical purposes, you can use a pulse width of about 1.5 to 2 milliseconds. So through observations, we know that at pulse widths of 1.5 to 2 milliseconds, you typically start achieving Rho base voltage. Now, what is the clinical implication of this? Sometimes people would say that, you know, my threshold is a little high, I'm requiring to give a lot. Let me increase the pulse width so that I can bring down my threshold. Now, you can obviously see the limitation of that approach. If you're typically going to come to pulse widths of around 1.5 to 2 milliseconds, increasing pulse widths beyond that will really not help you bring down the voltage of the or the threshold anymore, which is why you will see that many modern pacemakers limit the maximum pulse width which you can give to typically around 1.5 milliseconds, because increasing beyond that is really not going to help you, and it's only going to increase the battery drain. What is the importance of the curve that stimulation at the Kronaxy pulse width approaches the minimum threshold energy? So what is the importance of that? We want to basically give stimulation so that we can reliably achieve myocardial capture. But at the same time, we also want to try and conserve energy as much as possible. So we have a balance to achieve here between battery efficiency versus safety. So I want you to focus on these different points here in the strength duration relationship. So you have a couple of points here, C and D. So we said this point, Kronaxy point, which is close to the C, you can see here the green curve, which is the amount of energy which is being expended by the pacemaker to do the pacing at your particular settings. So you see that both with increasing pulse width as well as with increasing voltage, the energy requirement starts to go up. And there is a kind of a U-shaped curve where the minimum energy is expended pretty close to the Kronaxy point. So then in that case, should we just always program that particular threshold always close to the Kronaxy point, which is typically around 0.2 or so milliseconds? Should we do that? The only problem with that is you have to take the safety into account. Now, if a patient is pacemaker dependent, you want to program a way that even if there are some fluctuations in threshold, you do not stand the danger of losing capture. Now imagine if you're programming the pacemaker to an output which is close to the Kronaxy point here, and let us say you say at Kronaxy pulse width, my threshold is around 2. So I'm going to keep it at 2 at 0.2. Now this is pretty close to the duration curve. Therefore, even if your threshold fluctuates a little bit, and remember, the heart is a physiological and dynamic organ. The threshold which you measure at one particular point of time need not necessarily remain rock steady over the next several days or several weeks. Therefore, if you take this point here and you set a output of 2, suppose the threshold increased to 3, where are you're going to fall outside the curve here. So you have set the output at 2, but the threshold has gone up to 3 here, and then you can't achieve capture anymore. Because here in this steep part of the curve, even small fluctuations in your threshold is going to result in loss of capture. So therefore, even though the Kronaxy is probably the most energy efficient point, typically, therefore, you will not find the thresholds being programmed at Pranaxi pulse width. So points C and D suffer from the fact that small fluctuations in threshold, where we are close to the steep part of the curve, safety. Points A and B are therefore a little better because here you are in little flattish part of the curve where even if you have some fluctuations in threshold, you are not going to immediately lose capture. So that clinically speaking, most of the time, the nominal pulse widths in pacemakers are around 0.4 to 0.5 milliseconds. And looking at the threshold here, you can then give an adequate safety margin and reach this point E. So here you can see that if you have programmed an output and here at a pulse width of about say 0.4 or 0.45, if threshold is around 1.5, if you have then given an adequate safety margin, programmed your output at 3 volts, you are in a pretty safe zone. Even if there are some threshold fluctuations this way and that way, you're not going to lose capture. So battery efficiency is important, which is why you will not go to very high pulse widths, where you are not going to as such reduce your stimulation voltage much, but you will end up losing much more energy. At the same time, you want to give an adequate safety margin at an optimal pulse width so that you can also achieve energy efficiency. At the same time, you can have a reasonable safety limit. What we said, very short pulse durations are not very desirable. They put the thresholds close to the steep part of the curve. Whereas if you go to very long pulse widths, the slope of the strength duration curve is gradually flattening. And there, small changes in amplitude will not really result in capture loss. But at the same time, we don't want to go to a very long pulse width where you don't get much of a benefit for safety, but you expend a lot of energy. So which is why this typical pulse width duration you will find around milliseconds is where most of the programming is done for pacemakers. There are some more few points which is useful to know. I don't know if some of you would have assisted pacemaker implants, and you will find, or you can observe the next time, that when you measure the threshold, typically we measure the threshold by starting from high amplitude. We start pacing at say 4 volts or 5 volts, and then we keep coming down step by step, and then we come to a loss of capture where we see that okay, this is the threshold. If you try to do it the other way around, if you start with a low amplitude and keep increasing, sometimes the threshold which you achieve by that ascending way will be a little achieved by a descending way, and this is known as the Vedensky effect. This is important to know because you should not get flustered when you come down and you achieve a particular threshold. You say that at one I lost capture. Sometimes you might say, okay, let's go back to 1.1 and make sure we are capturing, and you may not capture, and you should not worry that okay, my lead has moved or I have lost capture. Just go up a little bit and come down again, and then you will find that your threshold is similar. The second tip is that just pace at a required rate. Suppose the patient's intrinsic rate is 50. Say pace at 60 or 70. There is no need to pace at 100 or 110 because at rapid pacing rates, you can have an artificial increase in threshold. So you should be telling the pacemaker technician who's helping you that, you know, just pace a little faster than the patient's intrinsic rate so that we can be sure of capture and loss of capture. Do not pace unnecessarily at very fast rates. Let's go to the next one now. We have looked at pacing and threshold. Let's look at impedance. Impedance is just resistance. So every electrical circuit has a resistance. You know that. But here we are using the term impedance. Now, in a pacemaker circuit, the impedance has two components. It has the electrical circuit's resistance itself, plus it has something which we call reactants, which are essentially the processes at the electrode-tissue interface which need to be taken into account. Unlike the simple electrical circuit at our home, where there is no living tissue to interact with it, Here the problem is we have an electrically active living tissue which is interacting with that particular circuit, and that is going to add its own dynamics to this component of resistance, which is why what we encounter is not just resistance, but it's a combination of resistance and something else, which is why we use the impedance. So what are the components of this so-called impedance? So first, you have the resistance in your conductor wire pathways, which is, you know, the same resistance as what any electrical wire is. Then you have a phenomenon of polarization at the electrode interface, which we will talk about. Then you have the resistance at the electrical, at the electrode tissue interface. So here, this is your conductor, and these are your electrodes at the tip, the cathode and the anode. And there are certain processes which are happening here at the electrode tissue interface that is contributing to the part of the resistance as well. And finally, you have some tissue between the cathode and the anode, and then that tissue will also contribute to some component of the resistance. So there are processes happening at this interface which have to be taken into account. So let's look at, first of all, the lead resistance. In other words, the conductor or the wire. Now it's logic that we want this resistance to be low. If we have a very high resistance wire, then you need to expend a lot of energy to overcome that resistance to be able to deliver a given current, because I is equal to V by R. So if your resistance is pretty high, you'll be wasting a lot of current as heat, and therefore the conductor resistance, you want it to be low so that you can decrease the current drain and conserve energy. Now in the lead itself, a very high resistance, what does it mean? It means that the wire is cut, the conductor is broken, or on the other possibility is that you have lost contact. The wire is hanging loose, it's not in contact with the tissue, or the connection is broken at the opposite end, which is a loose set screw. The lead is not properly screwed into the pacemaker pulse generator. So generally a very high resistance means one of these three issues. What about a very low resistance? It means that the insulation around the wire is gone and the current is leaking out freely all along. So here the resistance will be very low, but you're not going to deliver any current to where it matters. You're not going to deliver the current to the myocardium. It's going to be leaking out along the area of the insulation defect. So this is the general interpretation of very high and very low resistance. But a note of caution that a normal resistance does not completely rule out a damaged lead. Sometimes micro breaks in the conductor can happen in such a way that the contact becomes intermittent. The conductor wires can touch and move apart. They can touch and move apart. So at a given point of time, you may find a normal resistance, but that doesn't necessarily mean that the lead is normal. So if you find a very abnormal resistance, you know that something is wrong with the lead. But on the other hand, when you're encountering a malfunctioning lead, but you see that the resistance is normal, that shouldn't immediately reassure you that, okay, this means that there is no lead problem. You still have to test it and look at other parameters. So let's look at the next component now. We talked about the resistance at the conductor or the wire. What about the resistance at the electrode tissue interface? Now, the surface area of the electrode, which is contacting with the myocardium, the resistance is inversely and exponentially proportional to that. Okay. So what do we mean by that? Here on the x-axis, you have the surface area, which is progressive. And here on the y-axis, you have the resistance, which is increasing progressively. So the smaller the surface area, the greater the resistance at the electrode tissue interface. The larger the surface area of the electrode, the lower the resistance. Does this mean that you should have a big surface area to have a low resistance at the electrode tissue interface? Not really. This is because this is a little different from the conductor situation, the wire which we talked about so far. Here, what's going to happen is that when you reduce the surface area of the electrode, sure, your resistance is going to increase, but your current density is also going to go up. And remember, we said that what finally stimulates is the current density. So here, paradoxically, you actually need a small surface area. Think of the electrode as the tip of a hose pipe, which is spraying a jet of water, which is the actual current, which is going and hitting the myocardium. If you have an electrode with a small surface area, you're high resistance to the water coming out, but the water is going to come out in a sharp jet and it's going to be able to impact the myocardium. In other words, it's going to be able to deliver a high current density to a limited area of myocardium, which is enough to stimulate that particular place and start your self-propagating wave front. On the other hand, if you have a large surface area electrode, your resistance will be low, but then your current density, which is leaking out through a big surface area, is also going to be low, and you're going to need much more current to stimulate the myocardium. Therefore, your current density and your energy drain is lower with a small surface area electrode with a large resistance. So in the olden days, they used to have these polished big surface area electrodes. Nowadays, you will find that most lead electrodes have small geometric surface area and they are high impedance electrodes. So this concept is important to understand. Then there is one more component to polarization effect. So what is the polarization effect? When you apply an electrical stimulus to the heart, you are having a cathode which is negatively charged that is in contact with the myocardium. Typically, so the cathode is negative and you're delivering a negative charge at the tip electrode. So what's going to happen? It's going to attract positively charged ions from the surrounding tissue and the surrounding electrolyte fluid. And that positively charged set of ions will in turn attract a second set of negatively charged ions. This grouping phenomenon of positive and negatively charged particles is known as polarization. And this interface becomes an electrical bilayer at the electrode tip. So this is your electrode tip, this is your cathode, which is negatively charged. It's going to attract a bunch of positively charged ions around it, which in turn will attract another bunch of negatively charged ions around it. So here you have formed an electrical bilayer. You know that an electrical bilayer functions as a capacitor which can hold some charge and which has a particular voltage. What is the importance of that for us? This voltage which develops in this polarization effect is going to oppose the flow of current here. So you have a particular voltage which is developing here, and that is going to give a resistance to the current flow. So if you have a very large voltage developing here, again, your current requirement is going to increase. So how does this polarization effect work? The developed voltage is inversely proportional to the capacitance. And what is the capacitance? The capacitance increases as the surface area of this bilayer increases. So as the surface area increases, the capacitance increases. And since the voltage is inversely proportional, the voltage decreases. So finally, what it means is that if you have a large area polarization, you will drop the voltage which is resisting current flow. Therefore, you want to reduce polarization effect, and therefore you want a larger surface area here. So this is a bit of a problem. We just now said that as far as the electrode tip is concerned, we want the geometry so that we have a high current density. But we are saying for polarization that we need a larger area to reduce the polarization voltage. So how does one obtain a very large surface area to contact the tissue, but still you don't want to use a large diameter electrode so that your electrode tip still delivers high density current? This has been solved in modern electrodes by using the small geometric area, but a large interface area. So what do we mean by that? this is kind of, you can think it's kind of similar to the we can say the glomerular folds of the nephron or something like that. So this is an electron micrograph of an electrode tip. So you can see that the overall geometric area would be small, but many microfolds like this, this is an even more magnified view, many microfolds like this are incorporated on the tip of the electrode. This is known as microporous or a fractal surface electrode. So most pacing leads now have microporous or fractal tip electrodes, where you have a small geometric area, but you have a large interface area through these crevices, which is at the microscopic level going to interface with a lot of big surface area as far as the electrolyte interactions are concerned. Therefore, you effectively give a much larger area for the polarization to happen, thereby minimizing the polarization voltage and conserving energy efficiency. So you want a lead where your conductor or the wire resistance is low. Your tip resistance should be high by using a small geometric area electrode. And you want a microporous or a fractal electrode which will reduce the polarization voltage. So these are the technological nuances by which you make an efficient pacing. Other usual terms which are used, that is unipolar versus bipolar pacing. So what is bipolar pacing? Remember, always to complete an electrical circuit, you need two points. Again, we know this from basic physics. You need a positive and you need a negative terminal. So if you have a lead with two electrodes at the tip electrode is typically the cathode, the proximal or the ring electrode is the anode, and the circuit is completed between these two electrodes. It's a small sized circuit. This is known as bipolar pacing. Whereas in a unipolar system, you just have one electrode in contact with the myocardium. So you can easily understand this by this figure. Here is a unipolar electrode. You just have one electrode in contact with the myocardium. And how do you complete the circuit? Your pacemaker can act as the anode or the positive circuit. So you can see here that this is a large circuit. The stimulation is completed from here to here. Whereas a bipolar circuit, tip to ring, your circuit is a small circuit. Most modern pacemakers incorporate a bipolar mode of pacing. There are certain situations where you may think in terms of a unipolar pacing, but for most purposes, you would be using a bipolar. Why is the tip electrode a cathode? So why shouldn't you be doing anodal stimulation? Why do you generally do cathodal stimulation? That's because the positively charged anodal stimulation generally has higher thresholds. So you have more energy drain. Secondly, it has been found experimentally that anodal stimulation is potentially more arrhythmogenic. So you want to try and avoid anodal stimulation. In bipolar pacing, you can see that the electrodes are fairly close to each other. So when you are delivering current here, how do you prevent some stimulation of the anode? By making the anode a little larger in size and also by maintaining a certain inter-electrode distance, so that when you are stimulating, you're basically going to only stimulate the cathode and you're going to minimize anodal stimulation. But you can encounter once in a while anodal stimulation, especially when you're using, for example, in a CRT circuit, if you decide to use large pacing circuits, like for example, LV tip to RV ring, forced to use such configurations when you're struggling to achieve a good threshold or you're having a lot of myocardial scar, and you're having to use certain of these configurations, sometimes you can get anodal stimulation and you should watch out for it and be aware of that. Some other factors which affect threshold include the reaction of the tissue, which we'll talk about, the stability of your lead, how stable it is, and certain drugs and metabolic factors. The tissue reaction or the so-called lead maturation. So this is the phenomenon where immediately after you implant, there's going to be an inflammatory reaction or a foreign body reaction around the tip of the electrode. And because of the inflammation, a fibrous cap can form around it. This can result in a certain elevation of the threshold, which typically peaks about 4 to 6 weeks after implant. Now, this was the classical situation with the older generation of leaves. Nowadays, most of the time you don't encounter the so-called lead maturation, because universally now the leads are steroid eluting, which means that they have a small reservoir of a steroid at the lead tip, and it slowly keeps eluting out into the surrounding myocardium, effectively blunting this inflammatory reaction. And therefore, you don't really have this issue of lead maturation, which is why you'll find that, you know, in the previous era, most of the time the amplitude of stimulation used to be kept at about a month or 2 months before you gradually brought it down. Currently, it's not really required. Once you know that your lead position is stable and you are achieving a particular good threshold, then you can confidently set it to a relatively lower level. Now, also, in a lot of pacemakers now, you have automatic capture management, which we will talk about in the session on algorithms, which again takes a lot of, you know, effort out of your programming for the threshold issue. Of course, is important. Then certain drugs can affect, especially antiarrhythmic drugs, class 1A, class 1C agents, beta blockers, amiodarone. These can raise the pacing threshold. So if you're finding a sudden change in pacing threshold, think of whether there are any reversible factors. Did I start any new drugs? Did you start any antiarrhythmics? And then there are certain metabolic factors such as hypoxia, hypercarbia, acidosis, hyperkalemia. Now, all of these can matter, for example, in a sick patient. If a pacemaker patient gets admitted in the ICU for some critical illness, and there are some of these metabolic derangements, you might get called saying that, you know, the pacemaker is not pacing properly. And then you may have to see whether there are any of these potential reversible causes. So should keep in mind that the threshold is not just affected by pacemaker parameters, but biological changes or changes in the patient's clinical status can also sometimes affect the threshold. So let's come to the last part of today's talk, sensing. So you can say that apart from pacing, sensing is the other arm of the pacemaker function. And what is sensing? It is the ability of the pacemaker to detect the signals. Everybody has their own cardiac activity going on. So even when you have a conduction system disease, it's never like the conduction. You're going to have certain intrinsic cardiac signals which are always present. And it's important for the pacemaker to detect these intrinsic signals, be able to respond to it in an appropriate manner. So how is it able to do that? Using the same lead, pacing lead, which is in tip with the myocardium, when the vascularization passes that tip electrode, it is able to get that information, convey it to the pacemaker, and there the sensing electrodes basically clean up the signal, and then they are able to analyze it. Now, you have to understand the difference between the way the pacemaker looks at the cardiac activity versus how we are accustomed to seeing it by means of an ECG or an electrocardiogram. An ECG from two surface electrodes, at least two surface electrodes, okay, which is kept at some distance from the heart, which means you're keeping it on the surface of the chest. So that is a vectorial viewpoint of the entire electrical activity. If you take, for example, the P wave, it is not at one point in the atrium. It is telling you the information about the entire depolarization of the atrium. On the other hand, an electrogram is being recorded from a single point of contact with the myocardium, whether it be the atrium or be the ventricle. It's not giving you the information about the entire chamber, but it's telling you the point depolarization which is happening at that particular place. So this is an example of a right atrial electrogram. So it's going to typically be a sharp signal like this because you're just looking at one point activation. And all intracardiac signals are going to be in the form of electrograms. And this is what we see also in the EP lab every day when we put catheters into the heart. And we analyze intracardiac signals. What we are looking at are point activations or electrograms. So you have to understand that this is the information which the pacemaker is seeing, and this is the basis on which it is making decisions. The representation of that, as the myocardial depolarization is coming up, here is the wavefront of depolarization approaching the electrode tip and then receding away from it. So as it reaches the tip, you're going to inscribe a positive deflection, and as it recedes away, you're going to inscribe a negative deflection, and the sum total of this positive and negative deflection is taken up as the amplitude of the signal which is being sensed by the. Now, a sensed signal has certain characteristics. The two important ones which you need to know are the amplitude and the slew rate. The slew rate can also be called as the frequency content of the signal. So amplitude is straightforward. You can understand it is basically the size of the signal. So as I said, you are accounting for both the positive and the negative parts. You are taking the net height and you are expressing the amplitude in voltage. And typically, the values of intrinsic signals are in the range of millivolts. So contrast this with the pacing stimulus which you are giving, which we are talking about volts. Whereas the intrinsic depolarizations are typically in the range of millivolts. And then second is the frequency content or the slew rate. The slew rate is nothing but the rate of change of voltage. So how quickly does this voltage change? So it's delta V by delta T or volts per second. Now both of these are. Now the amplitude is important so that we have a certain strength of signal, and based on that strength of signal, we can adjust the parameters of how the pacemaker is going to sense the signal. The slew rate is important because different types of signals will have different slew rates. And this will be useful for the pacemaker to sort out which type of signal it is and then be able to focus on that particular signal which is of interest to it. For example, if you take ventricular EGMs, the slew rate is a little higher. It's about 2 to 3 volts per second. Typically for atrial EGMs, it's about 1 to 2 volts per second. Whereas if you take unwanted signals, we can call it, for example, T waves, or far field R waves. If you're having a lead sitting in the atrium, because the ventricle is so huge, some far field R waves can be seen by the atrial lead, but they will be typically be of a lower frequency. You can have other extraneous signals like myopotentials or external electromagnetic interference. They will be of a much higher frequency. So since our signals of interest belong to a particular frequency range, this also helps the pacemaker to be selective in what kind of signals it's. We talked about the pacing threshold and how threshold can fluctuate. Similarly, the amplitude of the sensed signal can also change, and this is important to keep in mind. So just like with pacing, we also need to give a safety margin. For example, at implantation, especially if you're using what we call screw-in or active fixation leads, you can have a current of injury in the myocardium, which typically subsides over a period of 10 to 20 minutes. And that can cause some fall in the sensing amplitude. Generally, it's not too much, but sometimes it can fall by a little value. And your initial pacing threshold can be high when there is a current of injury because the myocardium is a little bit injured there. Once that injury settles, the pacing threshold typically falls. Also, in the weeks after implantation, typically both amplitude and little bit due to some inflammatory response, and this is there even if you are using steroid-eluting leads. So to account for some fluctuations in the sensed signal, it's important to also have an adequate safety margin. An example of a injury current, you have immediately screwed in the lead, you are having an 18 millivolt R wave, but you can see this kind of what looks like an ST elevation, but remember this is an intracardiac electrogram, this is not an ECG, and then this current of injury ST elevation, and then over a period of time, this current of intensity will settle and become a stable signal. And in this particular case, the sensed R wave fell by around 5 millivolts. We talked about the intrinsic signal and the fact that it's important for the pacemaker to sense appropriately and sense the signal of interest. And this is important because most pacemakers are what we call demand pacemakers. And this is important because if the patient has his own intrinsic cardiac activity at a particular point in time, which can happen with a lot of intermittent conduction disorders. If you have intermittent AV block, if you have intermittent sinus bradycardia or sinus arrest, when the patient is having his own rate, you don't want to unnecessarily pace. And how will the pacemaker know? Only if it is able to appropriately sense the intrinsic signal. That is one fundamental function. Secondly, when you're going to multi-chamber pacing, such as dual chamber pacemakers and all, and we'll be doing timing cycles in the next session, you will find that all of the pacemaker's timing and synchronization depends essentially on proper sensing. So therefore, the pacemaker has to sense properly, and it has to sense only the relevant signal for that particular chamber. The atrial lead should be sensing only atrial activity. The ventricular lead should be sensing only ventricular activity. So both of under sensing, it means that the pacemaker is failing to sense the signal of interest, which is the depolarization in the respective chamber. What is this going to cause? It's going to cause inappropriate pacing. On the other hand, what is oversensing? There is actually nothing happening there, but the pacemaker falsely reads that there has been a depolarization in that particular chamber, and that happens because of some other signals which it is sensing. It could be some other myopotentials, it could be some of an external electromagnetic interference, or it could be the own physiologic events such as the T wave and or far field R waves and so forth. And oversensing is also a problem because it can lead to inappropriate pacing inhibition. And in a dual chamber pacemaker, it can cause problems with tracking of the sensed event. T wave oversensing. So look at the ECG here, which we have displayed for our understanding. You can make out immediately that these three pace events is followed by a unusual loss of pacing. And why is this happening? If you just look at the pacemaker annotation tells you what the pacemaker thinks is going on. So it tells you VP, VP, VP. Okay, it's pacing. And here you have a VS, which means the pacemaker is telling you, I saw a ventricular sensed event here. And therefore, since there is a sensed event, I'm not going to pace. But by correlation with the surface ECG, you know that there is no sensed R wave there. But what is sitting there is a little prominent T wave. So it has sensed the T wave, and what has happened? It has inappropriately inhibited itself. It has started its counting again from this V-sensed event, and only after the expiry of its interval, it has given the next V pace. The same issue has happened again. So this is an example of oversensing. So when we want to make sure that the pacemaker is going to sense appropriately, just like we are going to put a pacing threshold, giving a particular safety margin to ensure that the pacemaker is going to pace properly, you also need to have a sensing threshold. So what is the definition of a sensing threshold? This is also known as sensitivity. So you will be seeing the people talking adjusting the sensitivity, okay? And the sensitivity or the sensing threshold by definition is the lowest amplitude signal which will be recognized by the pacemaker. And this is a programmable value. You're going to set this value. So you're going to give a particular number and you're going to say that this is the minimum signal which you need for you to register this as a sensitive. If the signal is below this value, any signal above this value, yes, it is going to sense. So you can understand that the lower your value, the more sensitive the pacemaker. If you say my sensitivity is 2 millivolts, it means that any signal above 2 will be sensed. My sensitivity is 1 millivolt, it's more sensitive. Any signal above 1 itself will be sensed. Okay, so the pacemaker is more alert. Any signal exceeding 1 millivolt, it's going to say yes, there has been a sensed event. On the other hand, if you make the sensitivity 5 millivolts, all the signals up to 5 millivolts are going to be ignored. It is less sensitive. So this is something you need to keep in mind. If I say make it more sensitive, I am telling you to lower the value of the sensitivity. I'm telling you to lower the sensing threshold. If I say make it less sensitive, I'm telling you to increase the sensing threshold. Sensitivity like a wall. So let's imagine this person is the R wave which you want to see, the intrinsic depolarization. If you set a threshold of 5 millivolts, only those R waves which exceed this particular cutoff will be seen. And again, as I said, sensing signals can sometimes vary. If you imagine the person's height to be an R wave, if you think this person's height can vary over time, if this person becomes a little short, you're not going to see him anymore. So this is a less sensitive value where some fluctuation in amplitude of the intrinsic signal can result in a loss of sensing. Now, if you lower the sensitivity to 2, then you're seeing more of the person, or in other words, here much more height fluctuation is needed if at all you lose the sensitivity. Danger of not sensing is less. If even more sensitive, I'll reduce the sensing threshold to 1 millivolt, then yes, you have a very good safety. But the problem here is there may be some other unwanted signals lurking around, like this little devil here, which you are also going to start seeing from time to time. Therefore, you want a setting where you will have a reasonable safety to see the event of interest. At the same time, you don't want to make it so sensitive that you will start picking up some garbage. So that safety margin in sensing comes up. Typically or classically, the sensing threshold is at least kept at half of the measured signal. So when you're implanting the pacemaker, you're implanting a ventricular lead, your intrinsic measured signal is 10 millivolts. You typically want to keep your sensitivity at least five. You may want to lower it a little bit if you think that, you know, I'm not sure it's going to stay at 10. Maybe I'm seeing the signal fluctuating between 7 and 10, maybe 3.5. So you will find that nominally ventricular sensing channels typically operate at sensing thresholds of 2.5 to 3.5 millivolts. Atrial sensitivity thresholds are typically lower. Why? Because the atrium is a thin chamber and intrinsic. So atrial sensitivities are typically 0.3 to 0.6 millivolts. But remember, there is nothing sacrosanct about any of these values. In each patient, you have to look at the clinical situation, and if you are experiencing problems with sensing, you have to measure your intrinsic signal and then see which would be the appropriate sensitivity setting for this particular person so that I can overcome this whatever problem I'm encountering, whether it's oversensing or undersensing. Now again, thankfully for us, a lot of automation has come in. As I said, for threshold, most of the pacemakers nowadays, where the pacemaker is automatically able to adjust the thresholds as required. We will go into the details in a future session. Similarly, a lot of pacemakers incorporate auto adjustment of sensitivity. And this is an example of how this auto adjustment of sensitivity can work. So here, the pacemaker is constantly measuring and looking at the intrinsic signals. And therefore, it is setting these two limits, the on either side, and it is based on its measurement of the intrinsic signal, it is trying to see how should I adjust my sensing thresholds. So here it is seeing that the signal is barely exceeding the sensing thresholds. So it says barely sensing, I need to increase my sensitivity. So it pushes the sensitivity values down on both sides. And then it keeps doing that, converging on a 2:1 safety margin for sensing till it finally achieves that. And once it feels that it is going too much the other way, then it decreases the sensitivity a little bit once the 2:1 safety margin is achieved. So there can be various nuances in how different auto sensitivities work, but this is the essential principle, which is based on measuring the intrinsic signal and then dynamically adjusting safety margins so that you keep the adequate safety margin. And this is very useful because in any living tissue, nothing is going to remain static, neither your pacing threshold nor your intrinsic signals. So that is why these kind of constant measurements and adjustments are pretty useful. The other thing, we talked about the issue of frequency and slew rate and why is it useful. You can see the way the pacemaker typically makes use of the frequency content of the signal. So the signals of interest, namely the P waves and R waves, typically fall within a certain frequency range. The spurious signals such as T waves or far field R waves, for example, typically have a much lower frequency content. On the other hand, some of the other extraneous signals such as myopotentials, spectral muscle potentials, or electromagnetic interference typically have a much higher frequency. So the pacemaker is able to put a frequency filter like this, where it is good. Maximum sensitivity, here is your signal amplitude, maximum sensitivity in the frequency range of interest. And at frequencies on either extreme, it is going to sharply raise its threshold so that it kind of kicks out as much as possible the unwanted signals. So the frequency content is also taken into account by the pacemaker to ensure that it is physiologic signals of interest. So to summarize the signal processing, this is how it typically works. The electrodes and the lead sense the electrograms from inside the heart. It is going to an amplifier in the pacemaker's where it makes the signal to a decent size so that it can see and analyze it. It has a filter, which typically filters out unwanted frequencies and then gives you a filtered signal. It goes to a rectifier, which basically takes negative, positive, both sides and makes it into one net amplitude component. And this net amplitude component size is measured. If size meets your sensing threshold, then a sensed event is registered, and this sensed event is then sent to timing circuits to decide the next event of the pacemaker. So this is how the signal processing works in a pacemaker. So just like the pacing, again, you can have unipolar or bipolar sensing. So the unipolar sensing will be between the tip of the can, which is going to be a big circuit, or what we mean here, a big field of vision. Whereas a bipolar sensing is just going to be between tip and ring, which is going to be a small field of vision or a small antenna. So generally, the larger field of vision or the unipolar sensing is more susceptible to external signals because it is traversing a large area. The bipolar sensing is less susceptible to that. Now, having said that, though most of the times your default setting is a bipolar sensing, there are certain situations where if you're having a problem having adequate amplitude signals with bipolar sensing, you might switch to unipolar sensing. And all pacemakers do give you this as a programmable option to see whether you want to have bipolar sensing or unipolar sensing. Certain times, using unipolar sensing may help you to troubleshoot some sensing problems. So the last part, we are going to talk about blanking and refractory periods, and this will set the foundation for our next talk, which is going to be on timing cycles. What does the pacemaker do with this information of a sensed event? It starts certain periods, its timing. So two of the fundamental periods are blanking period. What is a blanking period? After a particular sensed event, the sense amplifier is completely turned off for a very short duration of time. In other words, the pacemaker becomes blind. It closes its eyes. So any event which is going to occur will be absolutely not be sensed by the pacemaker. What is the use of the blanking period? it prevents a single event from being sensed twice. Suppose you have an R wave. The R wave has a certain duration, okay? But you want the pacemaker to sense it only once. So the instantaneous depolarization should be sensed, but any lingering after effect of that should not be sensed. And this is typically achieved by blanking. This needs to be only for a very short period of time. Completely, the sensing is turned off and the same event is not counted twice. Or for example, a pacing spike is not sensed as a sensed event. Then after that, you have a little longer period, which is known as the refractory period. So don't confuse this with the refractory period of the myocardium. That is a physiological property of the myocardium. This is a function of the pacemaker. During the refractory period, you have the sensed, you have this the sensed amplifier being open, but the sensed event is not taken into account by the pacemaker, which means that sensed events happening in the refractory period will not alter pacemaker timing cycles. Okay, so we will see what is the use of the refractory period in a next session. So you can have various blanking and refractory periods. You have the same chamber blanking and refractory, which means within the atrium or within the ventricle. When you have multi-chamber pacing, you're also going to have cross-chamber blanking and refractory periods. So you will have refractory period in the A after a V-sensed event or paced event, a refractory periods in the V after A-sensed or A-paced events. And this is important to prevent oversensing of signals from the chambers. So based on this, you will have various types of blanking and refractory periods. And we will be covering this in more detail when we do the dual pacing cycles. So again, just like with pacing, you have various factors within the body also which can affect sensing, such as posture, exercise, respiration, myocardial changes, again, drugs and electrolyte abnormalities. So again, you need to think of biological factors as well. So to conclude, pacing and sensing are the two fundamental functions of a pacemaker. A significant automation and safety has resulted because of evolution in technology. Many times you will find with modern pacemakers that there are a lot of automatic algorithms which keep the safety in view. But still, you need to be aware of how these things work, and your clinical interference and programming can still be important from time to time to ensure the safety. So thank you for your attention. I'll just take any questions if they are there. So maybe I can look at the chat screen now to see. There we are seeing this one second.
Sir, your voice is not coming through, sir. For some reason, you got muted.
Sorry, I think by mistake, there's the mute button.
Yes, yes. Now it's better.
So did you hear the issue about how the polarization affects the thresholds? I think that part was audible.
Yes, sir. It was not audible. I think there is a message also just to, I think that's for a long, I think Rio Basin Pronaxy and the strength velocity curve. That's what they're asking to repeat again.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
So let me go to the Pronaxy. Okay. So here it is. I'm going to share the screen now again. Okay, right. Here it is. Okay, you're able to see the screen now? All right.